This system of silat that's being shown, which is termed Pukalan Chimandi Pusaka, Pukalan means hitting, Chimandi is flowing water, and Pusaka is valuable and old. So the art hits with a flowing motion and is something that was passed on from generation to generation, so it is valuable and old. I would like to give thanks to all the great teachers and pendekkers who have contributed to my training in this art, which include, but are not limited to, Guru John Malter, Pendekker Eddie Joffrey, Pendekker C. Wright, Mahaguru Arthur Remrev, and Pendekker Paul Detwars. Thank you very much for your interest in this Silat series, and I wish you the best of luck in your training. Selamat. Sanders, my title is Decker, and of Pukalan Chimandi Pusaka, which is a form of Pencak Silat. And in this tape of the fundamentals, I'm going to teach you the basics of the 18 jurus, or the beginning upper body movements of the system. Now, the jurus are very important because without the jurus, you do not have any base work of your system. There is no master key, so be very, very careful in practicing these and do these exactly the way I show you, and you'll be able to develop your system completely. Juru number one and juru number two are the what is considered male and female jurus of the system. One starts all the odd numbers, and two starts all the even numbers. So if you remember that, it'll help you when you're practicing the jurus. The basic position to start with, and we're going to do these from the right side. Keep in mind that you must practice them from the left side also, otherwise you become a one-sided fighter. However, because of length of tape involved, we're going to show you the techniques from the right side, left as a mirror image. Your right foot is brought up in the semba, or the beginning position, directly over the left foot. The right hand is in a half fist, and the left is cupped right over top, elbows held in so you can look directly over your hands. The first two moves of the juru number one are composed of what we call a stomping action with the feet in this manner. I'm going to go ahead and go through the juru, and then I'll explain to you in detail what this is for. The foot movement, or the foot position, is then obtained by stepping out with your foot at a slight 30-degree angle to the left. Your body is tilted forward. The left hand rolls out and hits in what is called a close range or contact blow. Left is pivoted, brought back with the left thumb on your chest, cocking your right elbow in such a manner. The elbow is then brought forward, hitting straight forward this way. You're looking right over top of your arms. The right hand is brought over, which is called a buka, set down, a straight punch, where the back leg is locked momentarily to give you an angle where your back and leg are angled straight into the ground so the force goes straight towards the opponent. Hand is brought back in open, not closed. Then we have an exchange this way, which is a close-in parry, set down, left punch, and back returns in a fist. It starts with a fist and ends with a fist. If you want to see it in a little bit more fluid manner, it looks something like this. That's juru number one. Now, although it appears like they're very basic movements, there is a lot of technique or meaning behind the movements. To give you an idea what it is, the foot stomping here is composed of destruction to the top of the feet. So when the person is actually approached to close range, we have a lot of stomping techniques that work this way. So the foot is actually destroyed and pinned, so a kind of technique can be used, and the person, when he falls, will not be able to move or get away from his leg being trapped. So that's what the stomping action is. This first movement here, although it appears to be just simply a stance, is also something that can be utilized. We do not do anything that cannot be utilized. Now follow along with me as I do it from a side angle, also noticing that all jurus end on what I call the open side, or the side that the leg is back on. That's because this is a flanking attack pattern. Now look at it again from the side, and we'll do it slowly and break it down for you. Watch tension on impact and snap on every move. Very relaxed. Tension only on impact. Extremely important. Tense, perfectly relaxed. Now we'll show you the application involving another person. This position right here appears to be nothing more than a stance. However, if you are in a fighting application and produce this movement out of a particular move where you stop for just an instant and the person threw a punch in low to your stomach, this would be a blow with the knuckles here falling with the rest of the juru or the rest of the techniques coming in. So it's actually a downward blow here, setting him up either for a fist or an elbow. From this position here, this move here is designed, if he blocks the punch, a traditional block, or it doesn't really matter, if he does a traditional block, a karate type block, and he blocks, this stops the block. The fist continues through the target. If he throws a blow with the other hand, and I do the same move, this eliminates it. I can hit with this hand, or I can re-counter and hit with this hand. From this position, from this hit here, this movement here that you saw in the juru could be this. Here, elbow. From this in-close position, which you are now into the person, the long range is not applicable anymore. If he tries to throw a punch to my head with this hand, this is the block with the blow here that comes straight up his arm and into his face. If then he tries to throw one with the other hand, you have the same block that you did in the juru over here encompassing this. Juru number one is a destructive juru, and its basic philosophy is forward, in, and destruct and destroy what's attacking you. Okay, very good. Now let's look at it again from a little different angle. From the stance, he throws a punch into the lower midsection. I hit down, which opens him up to any follow-up that you want to throw. The second move could possibly be, after I move in and I start to throw this punch, he attempts to block the punch. So as I throw it and he blocks, I re-counter his block or his hit and I hit him. If he throws with this hand over here, same thing, and I come straight up his arm and in with my counter. Once this punch is obtained and I hit, or even if I don't and this hand is in position, then this move on the juru is this move here, into the head. From that position, once I'm actually in close to him, if he tries to counter and throw a punch to my head with this hand, the buka comes in and the block comes down like this, going straight up his arm and into his face. If at this time he throws a blow with the other hand, we have this exchange, which is called, remember the double movement from the juru, and again a blow thrown in. Now, showing you a little bit of speed, we'll have him throw the low punch and the right and the left, just to give you an idea of how the blocks work. When executing juru one and all the jurus, it's very important to keep in mind that there's a particular attitude that you have to develop in reference to the juru. Now, there's three basic attitudes. Juru number one illustrated at a fluid attitude, which is something like you normally saw, which would be just going through the motions, relatively fluid. Juru number one with a training attitude would be going very, very slowly and emphasizing snap on the blows. Juru number one with an aggressive attitude is an entirely different situation where you're keying your mind for full aggressive combat, and it's something that you have to be able to learn to turn off and on, and there's a particular way to do that. If you key your mentality in with a certain word that you should develop, and you can make this word anything you want, when you're doing the aggressive attitude, repeat the word to yourself. And then do the aggressive attitude. Use it at no other times. If you do this, eventually you'll be able to key in a very aggressive attitude during a fighting situation, and you won't have to walk around in this keyed up mode all the time, which would be harmful for you. So an aggressive mode to the juru is full aggression, looks something like this. And that would be your full aggressive attitude. Juru 2, remember, is an even number juru, so it starts in a different position. The position for juru number 2, foot position is the same, starts this way. Two fingers of the left hand on top of the forearm, right arm parallel with the ground. The same stomping action is employed. Fist comes down, turns, hit up this way. The hand is brought underneath and opened up in a breaking motion here. Comes over top, hits down this way. Flips around, punch, open hand, exchanged exactly like juru number one now. So follow along just like juru number one. Punch and bring your hand back in a fist, because remember it begins with a fist and it ends with a fist. So to see it in somewhat of a fluid motion. Juru number two. Practical application of juru number two. The practical application of juru number two is stopping a kick that's coming in. Now, we don't generally parry kicks. We normally punch them, because the idea with the Silat systems is to destroy any oncoming weapon. So what you're doing here actually is simulating this first motion of a kick being brought in like a front snap kick to your extremity. So if I'm in a fighting stance and he brings a front snap kick to me, it's hammered down this way, straight into the shin or the top part of the foot to injure or damage the leg. Now, if he would produce a punch now, then this blow comes straight up underneath in the armpit or the soft muscular area of the arm to produce damage to the arm. So what you're actually doing here is hitting here, hitting up under the arm, and then the follow-up would be whatever you decided to produce after that. So if he had a quick kick and a punch combination, it would look something like this. And then follow up with whatever you're going to follow up with. From a different angle, the application looks like this. From a fighting stance, if the man throws a kick in with that leg, it's hammered straight down and a punch to my face. Notice my face is open here, very important. It's a decoy position. This blow is brought up, and also notice this hand is always here to check in case he redirects this hand back into my face. So a quick punch and a kick with this leg and that arm would look something like this. And a follow up, whatever kind of follow up that you wanted to use. A little faster application, if the man throws a kick with this leg and a punch with this hand, would look something like this. And then application to follow up whatever you wanted to do. Now this is juru number two. Follow along with me in review. Underneath, breaking motion here. Hit. Punch. Keep in mind that the applications I'm showing you are only a very few possibilities, and you can develop more of them on your own. I'll show you a few more to give your mind something to work on. The blow that I used under his arm could also be used as a blow to the bladder or the groin area. If the person, once this blow was delivered, bent down because it brought their head forward, this snapping motion in here is a neck break. That's what this motion is for right here. This motion coming around this way here is a destruction on the fist or the arm in a slightly different manner. If the person throws a punch at me with this hand here, and I hit it this way, then I turn it around and destroy the top of his arm. That could be an application utilizing this motion. The motion that you saw developing this is a camouflage blow, because in Chimandi, you do not want the person to know where the blow is coming from. So this type of a motion is usually done out of hand positions or hand rolls. So if you're rolling this way, the blow can come this way, or from here, the blow can come back up this way. So if you noticed in juru 2, you're rolling this way. So this hand camouflages the punch, and the punch is developed. Okay, this is juru number three. So like I explained to you, you do start with juru number one. So it's the same. Now right on the apogee of the last punch, your hand opens up, there's a revolving motion, and what they call a sangsot or long range hit. It's called long guard for long range. And this is the only juru that the punch is not brought back in on, it's left out. Applications on this juru are in grabbing, pulling, and undercut, what they type undercut type of a hitting. Now I'll show you the juru from this angle.